Many Christians throughout the centuries have given up their lives in love and obedience to their God. With Christ as their example, they have demonstrated the incredible grace of God by laying down their lives for others. The following story is probably one of the most moving displays of that grace that has happened in our time. The place was the jungle of eastern Ecuador, the time the mid-1950s. A number of missionary families had come to minister to various tribes in the Amazon Valley. Jim Elliot and his wife Elisabeth were among the group ministering to the Quechua Indians through Bible translation, evangelism, and caring for the overwhelming medical needs of the people. But Jim Elliot and the others were pioneer missionaries, praying that they would be able to minister to a tribe that had not yet heard the gospel. Their prayers were answered when they heard about a remote and primitive tribe named the Alcas.
Many missionaries had been praying for the Alcas for years, long before we got to Ecuador. We knew that they were Stone Age people, we knew that they wore no clothes, and we knew that they had killed apparently every stranger that had ever gone in there. But Jim and I and a few other missionaries that we knew were praying for them. Jim was especially hoping that someday God would send him to a tribe that had never heard the name of Jesus Christ. So it was a very thrilling day in 1955 when Nate Saint, the Missionary Aviation Fellowship pilot who served our station, came in with a very exciting piece of news that he had discovered the location of the Alcas. It was his idea to start what he called Operation Alca, which was an attempt to win their friendship by dropping gifts from the airplane. So he said to Jim, "Would you be willing to participate in Operation Alca?" Well, I've never seen Jim leap with any greater enthusiasm and less hesitation than he did to that invitation, and he said, "Of course." And so he began to take turns with Ed McCulley, the missionary who had been flying with Nate when they discovered the Alca houses. Nate was such a skillful flyer that he could fly low enough so that they were practically looking into their faces. And it was very obvious that they were showing signs of friendship. So after about 15 weeks of gift drops, they felt that it was time to make an attempt to reach these people face to face on the ground.
By this time, they had decided that it would be best for there to be at least 5 men involved. So they invited Peter Fleming, another missionary to the Quechuas, and Raj Udarian, who had been working with savage tribes in the area. It was these 5 men who met together on New Year's Day of 1956, praying and discussing their plans one last time before they actually flew into a sand spit on the Coradai River, which was on the edge of the Alca territory.
They sang together a hymn by Edith Cherry, "We Rest on Thee, Our Shield and Our Defender." And the following day, Nate flew these men one by one into this little sand strip, which was just barely 200 meters in length. We do have actual films of that landing, and pilots have said that it's an almost impossible piece of flying that Nate did, but he was able to fly each man in one by one. The sand, of course, was rather soft, so he couldn't take a heavy load. They set up a camp. This was the edge of Alca territory. They didn't want to go directly to the Alca houses because they might offend them. They set up a camp and prayed that God would bring the Alcas to them. Suddenly, on the afternoon of the fifth day, they heard a shout, and there came 3 Alcas out of the jungle on the other side of the river, 1 man and 2 women, all of them wearing the regulation Alca costume, which is a piece of string around the hips. They didn't seem to be the least bit afraid. They ate the food that the missionaries gave them. If you can imagine a primitive Indian eating a hamburger with ketchup and mustard and drinking a glass of lemonade. But that's what they did. And they spent several hours together. The men gave them gifts. They couldn't understand a word that the Alcas said, and of course the Alcas couldn't understand a word that they said. But later that evening, they disappeared back into the jungle, And the men radioed the good news to us. We were back on our own stations, each of us wives. Marge was continually monitoring the radio, since she always did that with her husband, Nate, when he was away. And they prayed that God would bring them back again, maybe with an invitation to visit the actual ALCA houses. And 2 days later, on a Sunday afternoon, Nate radioed to Marge that he had just flown over the ALCA houses again. He had seen a delegation of 10 who were headed apparently in the direction of the missionary camp. And he said, "We'll call you again at 4:30 this afternoon." But there was no message.
The wives of the missionaries waited 5 long days to hear of the fate of their husbands as a search party composed of Ecuadorian soldiers, missionaries, and Quechua guides made their way down through the forest to that beach on the Corridai. They reported back by radio that all 5 men had indeed been speared to death.
I remember the day, that Monday morning, when I learned that Jim was missing. The words that God brought to my mind immediately were from Isaiah 43, verse 2. "When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee, for I am the Lord thy God." And I realized that that was not a promise that God was going to bring my husband back alive. He was not saying, "If you pass through the waters," but "when." When the word finally came that they were all dead, again, God brought to my mind some words that I had memorized before. They were from a poem by F.W.H. Meyer called St. Paul. And the final stanza of that poem is, "So through life, death, through sorrow and through sinning, Christ shall suffice me, for he hath sufficed. Christ is the end, for Christ was the beginning."
To most, this would be the end of an overwhelmingly tragic and hopeless story. From a human standpoint, Elisabeth and the other wives had every right to return home in bitterness and despair. But Elisabeth knew that she could accept what had happened to her husband because indeed a loving God was in control. What happened next shocked and astonished the world.
I said, "Lord, if there's anything you want me to do about the ALCAs, I'm available." Not imagining for a moment that God was going to ask a widow with a baby to go into a situation in which 5 men had lost their lives. Having prayed that prayer, I just left it with God. And then in a very remarkable way, God did open the door. And in 1957, I was able to make contact with 2 ALCA women who had come out of their tribe. And they stayed with me for almost a year, during which time I was trying to learn their language. And by the end of that year, I had learned just barely enough of their language to understand that they were inviting me to go back in with them when they went home. And then, of course, the big question, what was I going to do about my daughter, who was then 3 years old? Was I going to take a 3-year-old child into a Stone Age tribe who had killed her father? A naked tribe, what might they do to her or to me? So it just comes down to, what does obedience to God mean? Jesus said, "If you lose your life for my sake, you'll find it." And I had to just beseech the Lord not to let me make a mistake. And when the time came, it was really very clear to me that this was what I was to do.
So 2.5 years after the death of her husband, Elisabeth Elliot, her daughter Valerie, and Rachel Saint, sister of the slain pilot, journeyed into the heart of the very tribe who had brutally murdered the 5 men. Miraculously, the women were warmly received and embraced by the tribe, The Alcas told her there would be no more bloodshed. Elisabeth and Valerie lived in peace with the Alcas for 2.5 years as Elisabeth worked on translating the Bible into the Alca language and living out the love of Jesus Christ before them.
And when I went in with my little daughter, so many people say, well, but what about medical help? What about the dangers of snakes and things like that? But it's a simple matter of saying, now, Lord, if this is what you want me to do, then you're responsible for the results. And we have to take every possible human precaution and leave the rest in God's hands. And Jesus put himself in the hands of wicked men. And he was nailed to a cross. And I am to take up my cross, which certainly at some point in my life is going to mean pain. Probably many points in my life it's going to mean pain. So because he has set this example of grace, then I know that anything that he asks me to do, he's going to give me the grace to do. I was sure that I could never survive losing my husband if God should take away this man that I had loved for 5.5 years and been married to only 27 months. I just said, Lord, I can't handle it. I can't survive. But here I am, 34 years later.